Hi, my name is May Colony Palau. I'm a bariatric and general surgeon at St. Elizabeth Hospital. Today we're going to talk about bariatric surgery for the next 15 to 20 minutes. This is a patient information seminar intended for those patients who are considering bariatric surgery, or they've already had the surgery in the past and they want to kind of refresh their memory about the benefits of bariatric surgery. So I'm May Conley Palau, I'm a bariatric and general surgeon. I did my training in medical school and Mayo Clinic in Rochester. And then I went over to Marshall Clinic for general surgery residency. And I went down south to Atlanta for a bariatric specific fellowship. And then I came back up to Wisconsin, was at St. Clair's in West End for a year, and now I'm at St. Elizabeth with Ascension. So today we're going to touch on the impact of excess weight, how obesity is doing in the world and the United States, the trends and the causes, what sort of weight loss options are there for you, including non-surgical and surgical. And we'll talk about the next steps. What happens after the seminar? What can you do to prepare yourself for this? So obesity is extremely common in the United States and the world. Over the last 20 years, we've seen an uptrend in morbid obesity and affecting at least two-thirds of the population who are overweight. And if you break it down to obesity, that's about 20%. Severe morbid obesity is about 5 to 10%. It is now a recognized medical disease by the NIH, and it is very serious and costly. We know that morbid obesity leads to a lot of comorbidities, which can cause yourself and everyone with the consequences of that disease. We know that the effects of morbid obesity can start out in childhood and are far-reaching and long-lasting. But fortunately, there are established and recognized treatment options for obesity. So obesity affects your life in different ways. It affects a person's quality of life. So just mundane, everyday things, you know, going to your car, or going up the stairs are very difficult when you're morbidly obese. Being morbidly obese can affect your mental well-being. It affects your psychological well-being, how you view your self-worth. And as I had mentioned before, the health effects of obesity are very costly and can be serious. So obesity is defined into several weight categories. It's defined as your weight over your height. So most of the patients that come and see me specifically have been struggling with their weight all of their life. And the patients that I see are typically in that orange and red category. So BMI greater than 35 or greater than 40. The obesity affects, it's worldwide. So there's nearly 2 billion people who are obese, and about two-thirds of people in the United States are simply overweight, like I had mentioned before. The effects of obesity start very early on. And so just from our numbers, we know that a significant number of children are already overweight, and this carries on into adulthood. Now, this is a website that gives you real-time information on the rates in the United States. You can search up this website, and you can go to your specific state, and it'll tell you what percentage of people who are overweight, obese, and morbidly obese are in that category. So here in Wisconsin, we're in the red zone. The purple zones are the highest. But there is a trend over time, the last 10 years, of the rates getting higher and higher. Obesity occurs when a patient or a person consumes more calories than he or she burns. That's a simple definition. But we know that there's multiple factors that contribute to obesity, which I'll touch upon these in the next few slides. So genetic factors. Obesity risk increases 2 to 3-fold if you have one patient or one parent that's obese, and 15-fold if both the parents are obese. So when you have someone say, oh, you know, my grandma was overweight, my dad is heavy, and I'm heavy. My siblings are heavy. There's a reason why. There's a genetic factor that carries on. Many children with obesity go on to become obese adults. That's about 60% of them. There's a gene that's located on the chromosome 16 called the FTL gene. This is the fat mass and obesity gene. And studies have shown that if you have two copies of this, you have a very high increased risk of obesity. This gene is also associated with diabetes. They're very closely interlinked. So if you have a normal FTL gene and you're very hungry and you get a meal, the normal response is to decrease your hunger level. This is working with GI gut hormones. Now, if you have a faulty FTL gene, then when you have a meal, this gene is still functioning and saying, oh, you're still hungry. And so it requires more work on your part in terms of exercise in order to decrease these hormone levels to tell you that your hunger has decreased. In terms of hormonal factors, there's several gut hormones that are at play for obesity. So you may have heard of a hormone called ghrelin. Ghrelin is a hormone that increases your hunger drive. So these hormone levels are very high that contribute to obesity. Leptin is the other hormone that's kind of on the opposite end of that, that decreases when the levels decrease your hunger when the levels are high. So it says when you have high levels, then you're not as hungry. These hormones affect insulin resistance and diabetes, leading to obesity. We know that people who lose weight via diets, so things like counting calories or keto diets, they do lose weight with this, but this is not a sustainable method of weight loss because these hormone levels actually increase a year to 15 months down the road because of your other hormone levels. Environmental factors such as foods, transportation, and activity have also a role in obesity. So our nutritional value, our access to fast food has become very easy. It's very easy to stop by, just drive through a fast food in the morning and grab something. These foods are typically in low nutritional value. They're usually a lot cheaper, and the serving size is a lot bigger. So if you compare our serving size to something like Japan, their size large there is our size small here. So the amount of calories that we're getting is a lot higher here. In terms of transportation, it's very convenient to take escalators. We have a lot of modern conveniences. This contributes to our sedentary lifestyle. And this is a real photo in San Diego, California, where it's a fitness center and there's an escalator going up and down. So this is just things that are very readily available in the United States that are contributing to obesity. Things like activity for children, going into the internet world and social media, it's very easy for them to just play games or have a very sedentary home life, and they're not going outside as much. So all of this contributes to obesity. So genetic, hormonal, and environmental that I had discussed, all of this affects the entire body. Obesity can affect almost all organs of your body. It affects your lungs, leading to sleep apnea, affects your heart, leading to high blood pressure, hyperlipidemia, meaning your cholesterol levels are increased. It can affect fertility for females and males, and obesity has been linked to several forms of cancer as well. We talked about the cost of obesity earlier on. These numbers are actually lower because these are old numbers, but your obesity can result in more visits to the ER, more visits to the doctor. A lot of it is tied in closely to those systemic body medical issues like diabetes, hypertension, heart disease. This results in more visits, more medication costs, and higher costs overall. So this chart is important. It shows that as your BMI increases, your mortality rate, it actually increases. So your rate of your risk of dying is actually higher as your BMI goes up. This is also closely related to the comorbidities that patients may have with increased BMI. And it's almost like an exponential curve. So it's really important that we address this. Weight loss options that are available. So you may have heard, these are non-surgical options that most of my patients have already tried by the time they get to me. So diet and exercise, changing their behavior. So putting the food somewhere else, or eating early at certain times of the day, weight loss programs like Weight Watchers, Jenny Craig, medications for weight loss, hypnosis, and even counseling. These have all been tried. And while they may work in the transient term, they're not long-term and sustainable. So bariatric surgery is actually the only thing in the right now that we have that is the most effective and the most durable for surgical weight, for a weight loss to help with the metabolic symptoms. So laparoscopic sleeve gastrectomy, you may have heard of a gastric bypass. Those two are the most common operations in the United States today. There is a laparoscopic band that you may have heard of, but we're taking a lot of bands out, so we're not doing that. The last two, the biliopancreatic diversion is our larger operation, and intragastric balloons is it's actually not a surgical option. It's where they place a balloon in within the stomach. Those are options to combat morbid obesity. This is a sleeve. So a sleeve is where about 80% of the stomach is removed. So the part with the arrow is excised out of the stomach, and then you're left with about a banana-sized stomach. This is a restrictive operation. It also changes your gut hormones, the one that I had mentioned earlier. This is a laparoscopic gastric bypass. So this is maybe something that you've heard of. This operation has been around for a long time, back in the 50s, actually. This operation is a tried and true operation. It restricts and malabsorbs as well to result in weight loss. Has a excellent efficacy rate on type 2 diabetes. All of these operations are done through small incisions, the recovery is actually pretty good. So do you qualify? So according to insurance policies and NIH, you qualify if your BMI is greater than 40. That automatically qualifies you for bariatric surgery. If your BMI is greater than 35 and you have the other comorbidities that are listed here, then and you just have to have one, then you typically will qualify. The steps after this, the surgery process takes a couple of hours. It's all laparoscopic. You stay in the hospital for 1 to 2 days, and most people are back to work by 1 or 2 weeks. The point of this operation is not to put you in bed or make you very sick, or you stay for a long prolonged course. This is a small incisions. The goal is to get you back to work and get you back on your life. I follow you very closely at post-op visits. So patients will come and see me at 2 weeks, 1 month, 3 months, 6 months, and then annually for about 3 to 5 years after their surgery. And we follow you closely to make sure that there's that support aspect so that you have the most weight loss that you can. So typically the steps to get to bariatric surgery are a consultation with a bariatric surgeon. You'd meet with a dietitian, have a psychological evaluation. These are mandated by insurance. Most patients will come to me actually from their primary care provider as a referral, but if they don't, if they're self-referred, some of the insurances will require a PCP referral as well. And we'll do preoperative labs and testing to make sure that you're fit for surgery, and pre-authorization of insurance. Well, thank you for joining me today for our seminar. If you want more information, please contact the General Surgery Office. The phone number is 920-730-4435. And we're located at 1501 South Madison Street. Thank you.